Second Corinthians, write this.
I am troubled.
Amen. Let's do it.
Tripped up and fell just a little. Every time the bruises healed up, just when thought I had it figured out, you went and turned my heart around. When you fall just a little, he's there and meets you in the middle. In all the places you feel attacked, feel pride and shame to his feet and back. Fall on me, fall on me, Jesus. Searching my thoughts, you're not leaving. Invade my heart and see it. You know just how to win me back. Lead me to peace and rest. Fall on me.
possess. All things are possible when we believe. Old chains are breakable when we receive Yahweh. You keep your promises. If you said it, we believe it. If you said it, hey, if you said it, we believe it. Say I am. I am who you say I am. against what you say.
Well, good morning, church. How is everybody? Good to see you. Sleepy? Yeah. Yeah. Hi. Hello to those online. Okay, so the first couple songs we're going to do, it's just me today, sorry, you're stuck with me. We're going to do them what I'd like to call it church camp style. So there will be some calls and responses, and I'll guide you through this. So let's stand together. And I would like for these first two songs we're going to do today to just be a celebration of our God and to sing this praise to Him. So here we go. Now you should know this one. If you don't, that's okay. It's really easy to learn. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Yeah, there you go. Let the songs of the Lord. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh, let it rise. All right, now let's do the clapping. I love the clapping. You know, I like the clapping. Without the clapping, it's just not the way it should be. So the question is, are we clapping on the one and the three or the two and the four? Two and four? Okay, so that's, so if we were doing one, two, three, four, one, clap. Hey, yeah, very good, good job.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise, let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Yeah. Oh, let it rise. Oh.
Take it up. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord, let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh.
Now you do this after me. Hail Jesus, you're my King.
There you go.
Your life frees me to sing. I will praise you all my days. You're perfect in all your ways. Hail Jesus, you're my Lord. I will obey your word. I want to see your kingdom come. Not my will, but yours be done. Glory, 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 glory to the Lamb. You'll take me into the land. We will conquer in your name and proclaim that Jesus reigns. Hail, 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 hail the line of Judah. How wonderful you are. Hail, hail the line of Judah. How powerful you are. Hail Jesus, you're my King. Your life frees me to sing. I will praise you all my days. You're perfect in all your ways. Hail Jesus, you're my Lord. Jesus, you're my Lord. I will obey your word. I want to see your kingdom come. Not my will, but yours be done. All right, take it up, glory, glory, glory to the Lamb. Amen. You'll take me into the land. We will conquer in your name and proclaim that Jesus reigns. Hail, 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 hail the line of Judah. How wonderful you are. Hail, hail the line of Judah. How powerful you are.
Amen. Hey, that was awesome. Good job.
Well, come on, everybody. Let's give God one more hand of praise. Come on. Well, good morning. God bless you. You may be seated in God's presence. This is the day that the Lord has made. We're shouting here at Common Ground Northeast. We're glad about it. We're excited that you have chosen to join us. Thank you for being here. And God bless you. If you're joining us online, we're excited that you are worshiping with us today. There's so much going on here at Common Ground Northeast, and we invite you to our digital bulletin to find out all the latest of what's happening. I want to give you just a brief synopsis of some things that are coming up. Vacation Bible School in a couple of weeks. Come on, let's give God praise for that. Pastor Jody and her staff are busy making great preparations. We're going to have a wonderful time. I want to invite everybody, go to the digital bulletin. If you know some children that would love to have a great experience, please invite them. That registration will be closing very soon. So we invite you to go to the digital bulletin, find out all the latest of what will be happening this summer at Vacation Bible School. My name is Ken. I should have said that at first. I'm co-lead pastor here with Pastor Eric. Pastor Eric and his family are away on sabbatical. We just know that we're praying for them. And we want everybody to just keep them in your well wishes. But he's not available now. He's away on sabbatical. If you're visiting with us for the first time, there's a red connection card. It's in the seat back pocket on this chair in front of you. If you're visiting us online, that can be found on our digital bulletin. Would you please take time to fill that out? We'd love to know how to connect with you. How should we be praying for you? What do you believe in God for? We want to come along with side you, add our faith to your faith, be a partner, believe in God for the things that you have been asking from him. So let me ask you a question. Does anybody love Jesus?
Yeah.
Anybody excited about Jesus? Come on, let's make some noise. Give God your best praise. Again, we're excited that you've chosen to worship with us today. At this time, we're going to have our engagement highlight. We're going to ask Courtney Miller if she would come give our engagement highlight.
Morning. So yesterday we had our 3-on-3 basketball tournaments. If I can be bold, I will say our first annual 3-on-3 basketball tournament.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. It was amazing. That makes me tear up thinking about it right now. We had representation from various groups around the city. We had Stop the Violence, Indy Pal Club, Police Athletic Club, a young men's mentoring group, along with some young guys from the neighborhood came out, and we had some great representation from Common Ground, too. We have some impressive ballers in our congregation.
Yeah.
We had three different divisions. We had a men's division, we had a teen, and we had a kids. And I believe the winning team for the men's division was Elbow. I'm not sure if that's who caught Twido or not, but you can check him out after service if you'd like. Shots fired. It's fine. Also, just wanted to say that hard work with purpose feels like joy. And yesterday, there was just a lot of joy out in our parking lot. And it would be impossible to recognize everyone, but we had people come and end up staying all day doing what would be considered kind of hard labor, doing points and calling plays, doing the bracket, managing like DJ, MC, food, all of that. I don't know how many games we had that were played. Almost 40 games were played yesterday and managed. So we had a lot going on, and the support from our Common Ground family was impressive. I also want to give a shout out to the older folks in this congregation. Do a lot of silent propping of the events that we have, and yesterday was no exception. They were there from the start to the finish doing a lot of the behind-the-scenes work. And I love being a part of a congregation where our old folks are like, get out of the way, we know how to do this, and then they do it. So it was just, we were blessed with great weather. I'm trying to hide the worst sunburn I've had since I was in college from yesterday, but there was just everything from start to finish. It was an inspired idea. The Holy Spirit showed up. We got phenomenal weather for it. The mood was wonderful. Great community building. It was a ton of fun. So thank you, Pastor Ken, for putting that on, and Wes and Charlie for helping out with that. And next year, sign up, get ready, start stretching, start getting ready, put your teams together. We're hoping to have it grow, and I think it will. It was wonderful. So if you guys now want to go ahead and dismiss from, oh, there's a video, I forgot. Which I made, I just forgot, but go ahead. All right. Y'all can go ahead and stand up and greet one another. Thank you. All right, you can make your way back to your seats. Back to your seats, but stay standing. We're gonna do our liturgy. All right, today I profess that I bring into the sanctuary a focused mind. I am leaving all my issues at your feet, casting all my cares upon you because you care for me. Today I bring into the sanctuary an open heart. Create in me a clean heart and continually renew the right spirit within me. Today I bring into the sanctuary attentive ears. Today I bring into the sanctuary a ready tongue. Today I bring unencumbered hands. Today I bring into the sanctuary my tithe and my offering. Today I bring into the sanctuary a prayer offering. Today I bring into the sanctuary my expectation.
Before you now, I stand before you now. The greatness of your renown. I have heard of the majesty and wonder of you, King of heaven in humility. I bow. As your love and wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in. Heard you calling my name. I have heard you calling my name. I have heard the song of love that you sing. I will let you draw me out beyond the shore into your grace, your grace, your grace, your grace. And wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter as your love. And wave after wave crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us.
You are not against us, champion of heaven. You made a way for all to enter in. You make me brave. You make me brave. You call me out beyond the shore into the waves. You make me brave. You make me brave. No fear can hinder now the love that made a way. You make me brave. You make me brave. You call me out beyond the shore into the waves. Amen. You make me brave. You make me brave. No fear can hinder now the promises you made. Crashes over me, crashes over me. For you are for us, you are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter. As your love, wave after wave, crashes over. Is over me, for you are for us, you are not against us, champion of heaven, you made a way, champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in.
Amen. Amen. All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. Let's pray this song. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've got one response.
I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. It's all that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, my soul. So come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your soul. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Let's sing that to him. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your soul. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. This morning to you, we praise you for this day. Thank you for a song to sing your love, a song to sing your praise. Thank you for our church and the people that make our church. We love you, Lord. So let's sing this. We'll sing this to the Lord. So I throw up my hands. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for my heart singing hallelujah.
Grace, your mercy, your kindness that your word declares has appeared to all of us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. Now, Father, I pray that as your word is proclaimed inside your house, but much more than that, we all profess that we had attentive ears and we all have an open heart. We brought it to you this morning. We didn't bring much, but we brought ears to hear, hearts to receive. Would you make a supernatural deposit this morning that will change us and not let us be the same? This we believe you for in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let me hear your best praise. I know it's not much. I know it's not much, right? But hallelujah. Thank you so much, Colin. It's just amazing, your ministry this morning. Praise the Lord, everybody. God bless you. I'm excited to be here. As you know, my name is Ken. I'm co-lead pastor here at Common Ground Northeast. I'm excited to be here. My counterpart, Pastor Eric Thien, is out on sabbatical. So we're praying for he and his family. So for the next 7 weeks or 8 weeks or so, I'll be preaching. And y'all didn't think I was the babysitter or nothing, right? All right, yeah. We're going to do our thing, right? We're going to do our thing. And I'm excited to be here today. Thank God for you. Thank God that you're here. I feel like I'm echoing a little bit, but there's a word from the Lord. And do me a favor. Why don't you lift your cup up before the Lord, and would you humbly say, fill my cup, Lord, and let it overflow. So I was praying about how to start this time when Eric's on sabbatical, and I'll be preaching to you for the next several weeks. And I concluded that I wanted to start here. Tell me what you think of this. Tell me if you think this is a good place to start. What if I said, I love you? Would that make a difference? Is that a good place to start? I'm going to start right there. I'm going to preach to you for the next several weeks, and you should know that I love you, all right? That's where I'm going to start. So in the Word of God, so for 2.5 years here, I felt like we've been plowing and tearing things up and planting, and I feel like it's harvest time. It's time to take in the harvest. And so as I was praying the other day, I want to draw your attention to Matthew chapter 9, beginning with verse 35. If you would go there, that's where we'll take the word from this morning. And did you hear me say that I loved you? Is that cool? All right, start there. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues. I'm proclaiming, here's something we need to explore, the gospel of the kingdom. What is that? And healing every disease and affliction. But when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Jesus said, the harvest truly is plenteous, but we've got a problem. We don't have enough people dedicated and committed, who care enough, who are moved with compassion like Jesus to take in the harvest. And therefore, some are going to die on the vine. Some will not be harvested. Some will not receive the love that Jesus died to secure for them. Jesus said the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Let's go back to the word. The Bible says that in verse 35, Jesus went throughout all of the cities. He was teaching in the synagogues and proclaiming. He was doing the official work of ministry, coming to the church, meeting people who had the resources or the auspices or the agenda to come and meet them there. But there's a whole nother group of people who didn't make it to the synagogue. What of them? What of those who didn't have the gas money? What are those who didn't have the itinerary? What about those who we will not meet on Sunday morning? Don't they need a touch? Don't they need a healing? So he was preaching the gospel of the kingdom. The Bible says that he was healing every disease and affliction. Jesus was doing what Jesus does. Has anybody here ever had an encounter with Jesus? And after you had an encounter with Jesus, things got better. And y'all, that's what's supposed to happen when people interface with Jesus. Things get better. Jesus went about all the cities and villages. As Jesus encountered the depth of human need, he was moved, the Bible says, with compassion. Jesus was not unfeeling or stoic in the face of people and their problems. The Bible declares that we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched by the feeling of our infirmities. The thing that we ascribe to him most is that he knows what it's like to walk the road we walk. And so then he is qualified. The Bible says that when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were, in one version, watch this church, harassed and helpless. In another version, he had compassion because they were weary and scattered. In another version, they were confused and helpless. All human plight, confusion, helplessness, brokenness, rejection, harassed, and scattered. And here the word used for compassion is the strongest word for pity in the Greek language. It describes the compassion which moves a person to the depths of their being. Jesus feels this. Then he said to his disciples, here's where I want to get for common ground this summer. I'm introducing what will be the focus of our summer right here. Then he said to his disciples, I see what's wrong. I know what's wrong. It's not them. It's not their pain. It's not their problem. It's not the human condition. That comes standard in life. It's that when I want to move on it, when I want to address it, I look around and I don't have enough people who have my heart toward them. I need to go on a recruiting campaign. I wonder, does anybody else see what I see? Here's the problem. The harvest is plentiful. There's more than you can put in the baskets. I just don't have anybody to go get the harvest. Does anybody have my heart? Does anybody see what I see? Does anybody else care? I'm not talking about I see it care. I'm talking about I see it and I want to do something about it care. Then Jesus said, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Jesus saw the greatness of human need as an opportunity. As the harvest was plentiful, a harvest is a good thing, and this harvest is plentiful. Around Common Ground Northeast, around this community, the harvest is plentiful. But it was also a harvest that needed laborers. The good of a harvest can go to waste if there are no laborers to take advantage of the bounty. Jesus warned us that the opportunities to meet human need and to bring people into his kingdom may be wasted because the shortage of those who have not only sees what he sees, church, but when seeing what he sees, feels what he feels. Then he gave us a solution. Jesus said, therefore, based on this dilemma, this dichotomy of a great possibility of harvest and not enough volunteers, I've just described the dilemma. He said, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. And Spurgeon says that this is a prayer that we must pray. But he says that anyone that would pray this prayer must first be convicted personally that I too must go into the harvest. So let me turn the page. Here's where I want to challenge Common Ground Northeast. Just like yesterday and over the last few weeks, what Jesus is talking about is putting the team together. So Jesus literally wants you to go on Planning Center and put your team together. Put your basketball team together. Except Jesus says you don't have to pay $10 and you don't have to sign a medical waiver. Jesus wants us at Common Ground Northeast to understand that we're a part of the team that he would use to bring in this great harvest. Now, I want you to think about who is, in your time of reading the Bible, who is that person, that character, that personality that you most identify with in Scripture? Just take a minute and think about that. Who is kind of your Bible heroine? The person that like, man, this person really did a great thing in Scripture. I want you to think about that. And then I want you, at a count of three, to just shout that person out. Who is that person? Who are those people? One, two, three. Who is that person? All right. Didn't say it loud enough. At the count of three, I want you to shout that person. This is my person. Like it's Mary, it's Martha, it's who. At the count of three, shout that person out. One, two, three. Yeah. Okay. It's too many people. I don't know what you said, but it's cool. There's an old sports analogy, and I want to teach it to you now. That when a team is behind, and they go in the locker room and they're behind, and say they play for the San Francisco 49ers or whoever, the announcer will say, they got to fix it in that locker room because Joe Montana is not getting ready to walk through that door. And what that means is perhaps this person did good for this team years ago. The problem is they're no longer on the roster. And if it's going to get fixed, guess who has to fix it? If it's going to happen, guess who has to do it? That person you just shouted out isn't going to walk in the doors at Common Ground Northeast. But if we're going to have a powerful church, guess who we're going to have to count on? It's not them, because they've done their thing. They've done their time. It's going to have to be us. If the community is going to be one, we have to win it. So Jesus is saying that we have to put the team together. So I'm going to give you the six T's of team. I kind of teach this corporately. Here are the six things that every team needs if we're going to be successful. So we're launching our summer, next week. And there's a particular vein of teaching that I'm going to do. But this is the six things that we all need. The first thing that every team needs, if you're going to take notes, is we have to have talent. We have to have people who understand that God has gifted them in a unique way. God has given everybody something. No team, Urban Meyer says, that if you walk in a locker room and you don't have any talent, walk out. That the first thing that every team needs in order to be successful is they have to do a talent assessment. Do we have anybody here to work with? The good news, and I heard it said yesterday, during the 3-on-3 tournament, somebody walked up to me and said, isn't it crazy that our small church has so much talent? God would not give us an objective and not give us the internal fortitude and resources, the gifting that we need to accomplish it. The Bible says that he led captivity captive And you know the scripture, he gave gifts unto men. That he gave everybody in the room some way to impact the objective. Come on, everybody, celebrate with me. We got the talent that we need. It's in the building. If you don't have any talent, go home. We're not going to be able to do it without talent. Talent is at a premium in our society. Talent in our current society is transient. You guys ever heard of something called transfer portal and NIL? What makes it, why has it exploded? It's because everybody knows you can't win without talent. And so now we're willing to pay for talent. And talent goes to the highest bidder. But in the church, who loves God and who loves the mission of God? And who will allow God to use them and give the talent that God gave them back to God and put it in his service? The second thing, you're going to hear a lot about this over the summer, is we need tenure. There is, I teach this corporately, there is sometimes a fascination, an over-fascination with youth, young and talented. So if I said the name John Calipari, would you know who I'm talking about? John Calipari for years coached Kentucky. Now something happened in March because his team didn't do well. The University of Kentucky, they were disenchanted with him. Highly paid. But he had a theory that worked at one time, no longer does, that he went and got the youngest, most talented people that he could find, and he made a basketball team out of them. And years ago, it went really well. But he was known for getting what was called one-and-done players, that they would come and spend 1 year at Kentucky before they went to the NBA. The problem was he probably had the most talented teams in the country, but they didn't have any experience. So they didn't win very much. So there has to be a great mix, if you're constructing a team, of people who are, yes, young and talented, but also you need some people who have been around for a while. You need some tenure. Don't go get rid of all of the people with gray hair, y'all. We need some experience. We need somebody like Elder Jenny who will hold the Band-Aid on. we need the talent. Y'all, but we need tenure. So in the 2008 Olympics, there was a who's who of American basketball players who were professional athletes, right? LeBron was on the team, Dwayne Wade was on the team, just a who's who, Dwight Howard, and they were supposed to win the gold medal without any type of challenge. Except in the gold medal game, they found themselves behind to Spain in the fourth quarter. The most talented team on planet Earth, and they were in a close game. So one person is credited with winning that game for them. Kobe Bryant went in the fourth quarter and just went off. Wouldn't let anybody else shoot, shot all the baskets, and single-handedly won the gold medal. And when they came out, they understood one thing. We need somebody who's good when nothing else is going well. We need people who understand, yes, everybody's good when the going is good, but who's good when it's not going good? And the only way you develop that is tenure. You have to have been there. So the second T is that God is developing here at Common Ground of these, is that we thank God for people who have been around for a while, who understand how to get through bad days and bad seasons. The third one is timing. Timing. It is understanding that if God is making us a great team, one that takes time, and then also we have to believe that we are in God's time. I believe that what we have been through in the 2 years, 2.5 years that I've been here, that we've struggled and we suffered a lot. I believe that this is our time to come together and win this community. So if you have great talent, if you have tenure, right, then it is this God's anointed time for us? Is this God's anointed time? I believe that this is God's anointed time. The fourth one would be training. That many times the reason it fails is because it's hard to get everybody thinking, as Jesus said in John chapter 17, the same thing, making us one, one in thought, one in deed, one in trajectory, one in understanding. What is the goal? Does everybody even know what the goal is? And so there has to be a season of training. So Michael Jordan is perhaps, I'm doing a lot of basketball, so we just had a tournament yesterday, the most talented basketball player arguably the world has known. And it is said that the reason Phil Jackson got to be the coach of the Bulls and won 6 championships with Michael Jordan is because when he was an assistant coach, that he said to Michael Jordan one day, "Hey, I need to talk to you." And Michael Jordan blew him off and said, like, "I'll get back to you. I'm busy." He says, "No, I need to talk to you now." And he held him at such a high level of accountability. And Michael Jordan says, "People don't talk to me like this." And so he had a high level of respect for Phil Jackson. And Phil Jackson was able to coach him hard. Now, we have to be able to receive training and receive admonishment from one another. In the Christian realm, the way that happens, that doesn't happen just through pastoring and preaching. The Bible has called us all to chastise one another, to bring one another into counsel, to bring one another into accountability. That the way it works in the Christian world is the Bible says that we are called to spur one another on to good works and to challenge one another and to encourage one another. That there's a unilateral element of training in the Christian world. Let me finish with these. And then the fifth one would be temperature. And that is the culture. Do we believe in God? Do we believe in one another? And do we believe in the mission? Do we believe in what God is calling us to do? Do we believe that God is calling us to be and to do something that would save the community, that would be a blessing to the community? Do we believe that? Do we believe that we're unique? Do we believe that we're on this corner at this time for such a cause as God would allow us to execute? It takes a high level of belief that one of the ways that Satan can cause you to abandon, to abort the mission of God is because God uses people. And if you don't believe in you, then it'll be hard for God to use you. We have to believe that, yes, I'm broken. Yes, I'm hurting. Yes, I'm flawed. Yes, I've had sin in my life. Yes, yes, there's a lot not to desire about me. But for some reason, God keeps waking me up every morning. For some reason, God keeps giving me grace. For some reason, God keeps giving me strength. He's looking beyond my faults and seeing my needs. Why does God keep doing that? Because he wants to use you. Because even if you would discount yourself, know that God has not discounted you. I know you've lived life. And anybody that has lived life has been through some struggles. Yes, you've had some bad days. Yes, you've made some mistakes. But God has not counted you out. And you should not count yourself out. You are fearfully and wonderfully made for such a time as this. Really, really, it's hard to be any good to this kingdom godly and kingdom initiative if you don't have some scratches, if you don't have some scrapes, if you never fell and you can't tell anybody how to get up. The kingdom needs that to help other people. The last one would be trajectory and tenacity. It is our ability to do the goal. So next week, when you come, there'll be balloons in the lobby, and we'll officially kind of launch our summer teaching. We're going to invite you next week to what we're calling the Soul Hot Summer. Right? So there's a gesture with it, like if it's so hot, you do this. But if it's so hot, we're doing this, right? We're asking God to light everybody's soul on fire this summer. Do me a favor. Look at your neighbor and say, I was here for the Soul Hot Summer. I'm here for the Soul Hot Summer. I'm praying that when we look back on this summer at Common Ground Northeast, we'll say to one another, remember that summer when the Spirit of God moved in the church and everybody, listen to me, watch what I'm saying, everybody in the church, their needle moved that summer. This is the Soul Hot Summer. So if it's so hot, right, it might be so hot and so hot, right? But this is the Soul Hot Summer. And I'm going to challenge us. So let me end like this. I started to have a picture up there, but I couldn't find it, of my basketball team at Tech, and I was there. And if I said Jeff George, y'all know who I'm talking about? Okay, so Jeff George's father was my high school basketball coach. And at the end of the year, he invited us all into a one-on-one meeting. And in my meeting with Mr. George, his name was Dave George, he told me everything I needed to do to get better. So for a few minutes, he's like, you own the team. That's not your problem. So you're not going to get cut. You own the team. But in order for us to get better, you got to get better. So everybody in here, this harvest team, oh, congratulations, you made it. You on the team. Let's be clear. You didn't get cut. You know, however you celebrate that. But now, here's the thing. When you go home this summer, Kenneth Rush, is what Mr. George told me, if you could move the needle in these areas when you come back, you'll be better, and as a result, we'll be better. Now, there's certain things, Kenneth Rush, that won't improve in season. You have to do this work outside of the season. You have to do this on your own, because we don't have time to practice your free throws in the season. You got to go do that on your own. And I'm asking you, I'm going to give you four areas, but I'm asking you to commit to being personally better so that we can be better. What is the work you should be doing on your own while nobody's watching? We don't want to watch you shoot 100 free throws. That don't excite us. We won't do that. You got to do that by yourself. But we'll know if you did it, and we'll know if you didn't. Amen? So, the soul hot summer, and to bring in the harvest, that I believe, man, we are positioned for this harvest. Like, I like that video. That video didn't do it justice. The Spirit of the Lord moved on our campus yesterday, right? And so now I know, and I'll tell you some reasons why I know. I knew yesterday was going to be amazing because there were miracles leading up to it. Last Friday, we washed the court off, and the court had a lot of opportunity areas, cracks, bad things. So we're praying. I said, man, we don't have a budget. I'm going to go fix this myself. So I went to Ace Hardware to get this cold brew, whatever, asphalt repair. Like, I don't know what I'm doing, really. So I called Brian. I was like, hey, man, there's no budget, but I'm going to put this in. And Brian said to me, who did all our asphalt work, I'll do it for you. I'm like, no, I got to do it because we won't have money for this in the budget. He said, if you let my son play, I'll do all the work for free. I'm like, man, your son can come and he can bring somebody. Like, so what does that mean to somebody like me, though? I read the tea leaves. That means God is moving. That timing question that we were asking earlier, no, I see that we in our time because God is sending people to help us. Right? I can paint the stripe. I don't know nothing about no asphalt. I don't even know what I'm pouring into coal. Don't worry about it. So now that stuff's in the shed. I got to take it back tomorrow. So I'm asking you to get better, and I'm going to preach in these four areas, and I'm done preaching today. When you come next week, it'll be the start of the Soul Hot Summer. Four areas I'm going to preach hard all the summer. One, spending more time with the Father. So I'm going to ask you to move the needle in that area. All right? Got to move the needle in that area. Oh, they up there now, so it's not the element of surprise. Okay. I want you to go back and have a personal scriptural revival. I want you to go back, kind of like, here's my line for next week. So when I say it next week, act like you ain't heard it. Like the Kellogg's commercial, Kellogg's Corn Flakes, I want you to go taste them again for the very first time. All right? So I'm going to say that again next week. I'm telling you I am. I want you to go back to the Bible like it's brand new. I want you to put it down, back away from it, exhale, and go pick up the Bible fresh. I want to see what that does, all right? I'm probably going to preach two sermons. Like, how much do we love God? As much as we love his word. How much do we trust God? As much as we trust his word. How much do we believe God? So the truth is, you don't have a relationship with God outside of his word. I'm going to bring that back up, right? You only know about God what you know about the word of God. So that's the second thing. I'm asking you, this is my Mr. George moment for everybody in the church. Kenneth Rush, go home and get better in these four areas, right? Common Ground Northeast, over the summer, get better at spending time with the Father and whatever the byproduct of that is. I want you to go back and have a personal scriptural revival. I'm going to preach to it. I want you to pray in faith, right? And the more you know about the Word of God, the more your prayer life will grow, right? Because really what we do in prayer at higher levels, we just tell God what God told us, right? And then the fellowship with other believers. And if we move the needle in those four areas, when we come back in the fall, we'll see where that gets us, okay? So that's the agenda. That's the goal. We'll launch this next week, balloons in the lobby. And I want you to invite people to come and be a part of the Soul Hot Summer at Common Ground Northeast. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give God a praise for us. Father, I thank you for this day, for for this time of sharing. Thank you for lighting our souls on fire this summer. I just feel that in small things, you have a way of letting us know that you're with us. When I called Brian, I legitimately only wanted him to tell me if I was about to mess up the asphalt. I never expected him to say, "I'll do it." But because you had him say, "I'll do it," you were letting us know that there's a part we can do and there's a part you have to do, and you are more than able to do the part you have to do. You send people to do the part you have to do. And I thank you for that, because that thing let me know, oh God, you are anointing this. And I want to say this, you sent Wes and Charlie, and man, did that take that thing to the next level. You got people, and people got talent. Help us to submit our talent to you. So many people helped. Now, God, why did you assemble this team? What is it that you want to win through this assembly of talent at Common Ground Northeast? We want to do your objective, and we hear you saying, it's out of season now, so just go get better. And we've identified four areas that we want to get better in. And I pray that everybody will put in the work. Come back stronger. Come back better. In Jesus' name, amen. Whenever the word of the Lord is preached, it requires a response. There are several ways to respond to the word of God. Give, pray, volunteer. Thank you for such an amazing volunteer effort yesterday. It could not have been any better. Thank you so much. And because of it, we touch people in ways we would not know. If you want to commune today, there are provisions made for you. Please move, go. Commune around this idea. I'm going to move the needle personally. I want you to know, this is my personal commitment to you. I'm excited to be co-pastor here with Eric. I need to get better. Not for the objective. I just need to be personally better. So here's my vow to you. I'm going to go get better. I know how to do it. I just got to spend more time with God. I'm challenging you to do the same thing. Commune around the idea of getting better. Come on, everybody. Let's give God praise for his word.
So come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. Cause all that I have, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
listen, will you go receiving that challenge? Will you go and invite somebody to come back next week? Say, hey, we're having a Soul High Summer at our church. I meant to also poll you. How many of you would be open to having service out on the basketball court? Would anybody be open to that? Yeah. Email me and let me know. I plan to do that, by the way. So, thank you all so very much. It was an amazing experience. It let me know the gifted, the talented, the anointing that's on our church. God wants to use us. We got to go get better. Again, thank you. No gesture for me, though. I'm extremely conscientious. I watch everything. If you blew off the court, if you set up a table, I saw it. I'm grateful. It's what we need to do because we are a team. We are a team. Do me a favor. We're going to do it a little bit for different. My commitment to Eric, Eric's commitment to me was, Ken, anything you want to change, you should change it while I'm gone. I'm like, I will. I'm like, don't worry. My goal is for the church to look totally different when you get back. But I just put it out there. Do me a favor, we're going to dismiss a little different. Look at your neighbor and say, this is your week. God said a little louder, tell them, this is your week. The devil is defeated. And God is exalted. And what you do this week. Tell them, based upon that, I've got an assignment for you. Go make God glad. Go make the devil mad. God bless you. Go and have a good week.